the last part of the case history, which includes the intraoral examination of the oral cavity, and which is further classified into the soft tissues as well as the hard tissues. Coming to the soft tissues, which is further classified as either the soft tissues of the oral cavity like buccal mucosa, alveolar mucosa, labial mucosa, palate and tongue, which even includes cranial attachment. And if at all you have any findings with regard to these mucosa, you can either write it as no abnormalities detected. Coming to the next part, that is gingiva, which is the most important part in related to the soft tissues or the oral cavity. So, which is subdivided into 8 subcategories, which are the color, contour, consistency, size and shape, surface texture, position, leading on probing, and finally exudate. So you can see that 3 C's are there, that is color, contour, consistency, 2 S are there, size and shape and surface texture, then leading on probing, exudate along with the position. So coming to the first part, that is color. Usually most of them will be writing as coral pink. Actually coral pink is applicable only for the Western East countries. In our countries like India, you can write it as pale pink. And if at all there is any abnormalities or pathological condition, you can write it as reddish pink. So coming to the next one, that is contour. In contour, you can subdivide into 2 parts. That is, one is to related to the margin gingiva and other is related to the interdental papilla. Coming to the marginal, it will be in a scallop form. You know this scallop or the singular appearance, scallop form. And if it is in a pathological condition, you can write it as fossa scalloping. And in the interdental papilla, usually it will be knife edge. And in the pathological condition, you can write it as blunt interdental papilla or even rolled out interdental papilla during the pathological conditions. So this comparison is that of a contour. So color, contour. And coming to the next one, that is consistency. Usually the consistency of the gingiva will be firm and resilient, and if it is a pathological condition, you can write it as soft and edematous. What are the findings? So far you have seen color, contour and consistency. Oh, so okay, but irrespective of all the findings, always mention the factors. If it is a pathological condition, mention the tooth number or a particular quadrant, or generalized or localized. Usually for generalization, it will be more than 30% of the tooth involved. So always mention in relation to, for example, as 4-6 or lower anteriors, like that. Don't mention it as leading and probing, like that. Don't mention it. Okay. Then coming to the size and shape, usually if it is a pathological condition, you can mention it as altered. Otherwise, you can mention it as not altered. Coming to the next one, that is the surface structure. Usually stippling is seen, but in pathological condition the stippling will not be seen. And what is stippling? Usually the stipplings are the soft tissue, connective tissue projections, which are seen in the attached gingiva. So stippling are the connective tissue projections which are seen in the attached gingiva. So how you can see? By wiping out the cotton, you can see an orange peel appearance, that is the stippling. So coming to the next aspect, that is position. Usually what is position? So position is the apical migration of the gingival margin, that is that it is also called as recession. And what are the cross questions you will be asked during recession is, what are the various classifications you know in regard to recession? That is, one is Miller's classification, which is given in the year 1985. And you can see the 4 categories of Miller's classification. That is, whether the gingival margin is extending up to mucogingival junction or not, and whether bone loss involvement is there or not, or even the soft tissue involvement is there or not. So the following 4 categories, even you can see it in the background. So that is with respect to Miller's classification. The other classification for recession is Sullivan's. That is 4 categories again, which is shallow narrow, shallow wide, deep narrow and deep wide. This is regard to that of recession or position. This is also you should mention with regard to which teeth or which sextant or which quadrant. Coming to the next one, that is bleeding on probing. Again, you have to mention with regard to which teeth. And finally, you can mention it as whether any pus discharge is there or not in exudate. Coming to the hard tissues, usually we will be starting up with the how many number of teeth are present, 30, 32, whatever. Then coming to the most important part, that is teeth notation. And in the backdrop, you can see the various teeth notation available. And the most important types are universal or the national system, which is given in the year 1812, followed by Zsigmondy or Kalman notation, given in the year 1861, and then mostly followed by many in the main case history is FDA notation, which was given in the year 1971, which is mostly acceptable or the one which is followed regularly in the case history part. And also other teeth notation like Dane Hairdrop system, Navy system, Bosworth system. You can see it in the backdrop also. And you can see the little difference between the universal or the national system of teeth notation and the Navy system, where the 16 will be ending up with the second quadrant third molar, and the 17 will be starting from the third molar of the third quadrant. Whereas in the Navy system, you can see the 17 will be starting from the third molar of the fourth quadrant. So this is the difference you can see between the universal system as well as in the Navy system. Coming to the next aspect, that is you can mention it about the calculus stains, whether it is present or not. And usually you can ask the cross questions, define calculus, what are the constituents present in the calculus, and what is the time duration for the plaque to mature into a calculus. These are the cross questions you will be asked. Same thing which is applied even to the stains. And you can even ask the cross question for the stains, what any other classifications are there for stains, like Globian index, Nathu's classification for stains. Coming to the next one, again everyone will be mentioning up what are the dental caries, present tooth and filled tooth and the missing tooth. These are the other findings you will be writing in regard to heart tissues. Coming to the next aspect, usually I will be asking everyone to mention whether the findings are present to the particular person or not. You can write it as non-vital, fractured teeth, supernumerary teeth, everything, and mobile teeth. So with regard to non-vital teeth and fracture, there is a classification like LE's classification. Even in the backdrop, you can see the various classification of LE's, starting from the enamel fracture, dentinal fracture, pulp involvement, non-vital, avulsion, root fracture with or without involving the crown, followed by the displacement, crown and moss, and finally the ninth classification is regard to that of a primary teeth. Coming to the next finding, that is mobility or the pathological migration. Usually you will be asked with the cross questions like, is there any classification with regard to that of a mobility? You can see it is again given by Miller's, as well as another classification given by Glickman's. You can see in the backdrop the various classification which I have told. And you can usually it will be like various classes, like whether it is the teeth is mobile in the buccolingual direction, or even in the final category like apico-occlusal direction. So also again another cross question you will be asked, you know about anything about premitus. Again it is a palpable vibration which are present in the teeth, that is called as premitus. So with regard to that mobility, these are the various cross questions you will be asked. Coming to the next one, that is wasting disease. Usually wasting disease include attrition, abrasion, erosion, and finally abfraction. There is another aspect like ablation. Ablation is nothing but the removal of soft tissue by instrument, sharp instrument. And what are the various differences between attrition, abrasion, and erosion? Coming to the attrition, usually it is a physiological wearing away of the tooth surface due to tooth-to-tooth contact or by mastication force, usually by tobacco chewing also. This is physiological, so it is attrition. Coming to the abrasion, it is a pathological wearing of the tooth, usually by the abnormal mechanical forces like faulty tooth brushing. So you can see various patients complaining of cervical abrasion. Coming to the last aspect, that is erosion. It is usually by the chemical injuries like citric acid juices or even by bulimia nervosa. So coming to the next one, that is another aspect, that is of a fraction. It is nothing but a notching type of impression which will be seeing in the cemento enamel junction, that is abfraction. So this concludes with the wasting diseases. So with regard to various heart tissue examinations, you can see next we can move on to occlusal aspects. In occlusion again, you will be seeing for overjet, overbite, and also any rotations of person, and find it will be the molar occlusion. In molar occlusion, there may be various cross questions. First, you can see what is the normal occlusion. We all know that the BCO buccal cusp of the upper permanent molar should rest in the buccal groove of the lower first permanent molar. And what are the various other forms? That is class 2. What is class 2 division 1 and what is class 2 division 2? Maybe another cross question. And class 2, you know, not the BCO one, that is the distal buccal cusp will be lying in the buccal groove of the lower first permanent molar. And coming to the class 3, you can see that is in the concavity, that is in the maxillary retrogradism or mandibular prognathism, you can say the concavity. So usually what happens is that the BCO buccal cusp of the upper permanent molar will be lying in the interdental space between the lower first and the second permanent molars. So this is with regard to that of occlusal aspects. And again, there is subclassifications for class 3 like true and pseudo. And any other questions which are asked is usually this is Angle's type of classification which we are following. Any other classification if the examiner is going to cross question you, you can say it as Ackermann Profits classification, which again you can see 5 system, you can see it in the backup which consists of 5 points. And another cross question you will be asked is what are the various keys of occlusion which is given by Andrews. There are totally 6 keys of Andrews keys of occlusion. So after finishing up with all the hot tissue examination, you are coming to the provisional diagnosis. What is provisional diagnosis? Under surveys, you are not able to confirm it with the naked eye. You can write the findings in the provisional diagnosis. Simple, like usually gingivitis, you can see it with your naked eye. So no need of any intraoral atypical radiographs or any biopsy is needed to say that this is having a partial adhesion space or gingivitis. So this you can directly write it in the final diagnosis. Suppose the patient is having a dental caries in a particular teeth and you are having a slight doubt, or the patient is having a pain and you are doubting that whether to go for a root canal treatment or not. So that type of doubtful findings you can write it in the provisional diagnosis. Also like the findings like white lesions, if you have a doubt whether it is a leukoplakia or like a planus or candidiasis whatever, then you can write it in the provisional diagnosis followed by the investigations. Investigations you can write it either like impaired tooth, also you can go for OPG, orthopentagraph, intraoral periapical radiograph with a particular teeth, or biopsy, exfoliative cytology. Everything coming under the investigations, and then you can move on to the final diagnosis. Usually the those you are confirmed with the naked eye itself, you can write it in the final diagnosis. So this concludes the case history part. And finally, you will be writing with the treatment plan for the particular patient. And usually you can follow the standard textbook like Carranza, where you can see the various phases. Usually it will be starting with the emergency phase. That is, that we always noted that the patient is having a severe complaint or pain, like pain, directly right in the emergency phase. The patient complains of pain in the particular teeth. Okay, well, then you can move on to the next phases like heterotrophic phase or the phase 1, where you can include the prophylactic factors, also the diet counseling, tobacco cessation counseling, everything will be included under the heterotrophic phase or the phase 1, followed by the surgical phase or the phase 2, and followed by restorative phase of phase 3, and finally the maintenance phase or the phase 4. So these are the various treatment plan or the phases we will be following. So okay, then after completing the treatment plan, you can finally move on to the various levels of prevention for the particular patient. Usually you know that primordial prevention is the purest form of the primary prevention. So okay, it is the avoidance of the emergence of the risk factors as we are following in the book. Mostly we are going to the primary prevention. What are the various modes of intervention in the primary prevention? As you know, that is health promotion and specific protection. Usually the OHI instructions, oral hygiene instructions, or the diet counseling instructions, everything you can include in the primary prevention. Also, that specific, what are the other mode of intervention is specific protection. Generally, we will spare the vaccines, written fish sealants, topical fluorides, everything comes under specific protection. So, everything comes with that of this diet counseling and the oral hygiene instructions comes with the primary prevention aspects. Coming to the next one, that is the secondary prevention. What is the mode of intervention? Early diagnosis and prompt treatment. Early diagnosis. Usually you will say that if cancer is early diagnosed, it can be curable. This can be prevented at the earliest. So, coming under to the secondary prevention, scaling for prophylaxis. Normal treatment, normal endodontic treatment like restorations can be done in the early diagnosis and a prompt treatment, that is in the secondary prevention. And unless otherwise, then you can move on to the tertiary prevention, which includes disability limitation and rehabilitation. Disability limitation, that is before going for extraction, if the teeth can be saved or not, what you will do, you will be doing for root canal treatment. So RCT comes under disability limitation under tertiary prevention. Now sir, the teeth is extracted and it is removed. So what will be the treatment plan or the levels of prevention? That is rehabilitation. You have to either replace the missing tooth by implants, if it's a possible dentures, or either by removable possible dentures. So this comprises that of the tertiary level of prevention. So always finish with the treatment plan and the levels of prevention.